Om Namah Shivaya students, we were reading the story The Enemy and we saw that the injured man is completely out of danger as Sadao and his wife Hannah is continually trying to save him. So now let us read. They looked at each other for a moment and then the young man closed his eyes and turned his face to the wall. "Okay," he whispered, his mouth a bitter line. Outside the door, Hannah was waiting for Sadao. He saw at once that she was in trouble. So Sadao and the boy exchanged glances and then the boy closed his eyes and turned his face towards the wall. He said okay in a low voice as he felt bitter by Sadao's words. Outside the door, Hannah was waiting for Sadao. He saw that she was in some kind of trouble. "Sadao, Yumi tells me the servants feel they cannot stay if we hide this man here anymore," she said. "She tells me that they are saying that you and I were so long in America that we have forgotten to think of our country first. They think we like Americans." "It is not true," Sadao said harshly. "Americans are our enemies, but I have been trained not to let a man die if I can help it." So Hannah said to Sadao that Yumi told her that the servants would not stay with them if the American man lived there any longer. She also said that Sadao and Hannah had been in America for such a long time that they had forgotten their country's priority. Yumi and the servants thought that Sadao and Hannah liked Americans. Sadao reacted harshly and said that this was not true. He said that Americans were their enemies. He had been trained in such a way that he could not let a man die and would help to save him in whichever way he could. That was what Sadao had done. So here we see that the harshest criticism the servants can master is that Hannah and Sadao actually are fond of Americans. Folded into this accusation is a criticism of the couple's lack of patriotism, which the servants see as disrespectful and dangerous. "The servants cannot understand that," she said anxiously. "No," he agreed. Neither seemed able to see more. And somehow the household dragged on. The servants grew more watchful. Their curtsy was as careful as ever, but their eyes were cold upon the pair to whom they were hired. "It is clear what our master ought to do," the old gardener said one morning. He had worked with flowers all his life and had been a specialist too in moss. For Sadao's father, he had made one of the finest moss gardens in Japan, sweeping the bright green carpet constantly so that not a leaf or a pine needle marred the velvet of its surface. "My old master's son knows very well what he ought to do," he now said, pinching a bud from a bush as he spoke. "When the man was so near death, why did he not let him bleed?" So one morning, the old gardener said that it was obvious that their master should have done something else. The old gardener had worked with flowers all his life and specialized in moss. He had been employed by Sadao's father. The gardener had made one of the best moss gardens in Japan for Sadao's father. The gardener would sweep the bright green colored carpet of the moss so that the sharp leaves of pine tree could not spoil the soft velvety surface. He plucked a flower bud from the bush as he said that his master's son, that is Sadao, knew it very well what he was supposed to do. He added that when the man was almost dead, he should have left him to bleed to death. The gardener's old age and loyal ties to Sadao's father suggests that the two are similar in their narrow, prejudiced view of the world. It seems as if the gardener feels he has a duty to his old master more so than to his old master's son, and is thus more critical of Sadao as a result. That young master is so proud of his skill to save life that he saves any life, the cook said contemptuously. She split a foul snake skillfully and held the fluttering bird and let its blood flow into the roots of a wistaria vine. Blood is the best of fertilizers, and the old gardener would not let her waste a drop of it. It is the children of whom we must think, Yumi said sadly. What will be their fate if their father is condemned as a traitor? So the cook said disrespectfully that their master was so proud of his skill at saving lives that he did not bother whose life he was saving. She cut the neck of a hen skillfully and held the bird as it shivered. She let the blood of the hen flow into the wistaria vine. The old gardener had instructed her that blood was the best fertilizer for the plants, and he did not allow her to waste a single drop of it. Yumi was worried about the fate of Sadao and Hana's children. She wondered that when they grew up, they would be labeled as traitors' children. As Sadao was helping an American, all the people of Japan would consider him to be an enemy of Japan, a traitor of his own country. The way that the cook and the gardener shared the blood from the fowl links them to the old Japanese way of doing things, which Sadao's father was so committed to. The phrase, blood is the best of fertilizers, is ominous, suggesting that Tom's blood spilt on Japanese land is a good thing for Japan's growth. They did not try to hide what they said from the ears of Hannah as she stood arranging the day's flowers in the veranda nearby, and she knew they spoke on purpose that she might hear. That they were right, she knew too, in most of her being, but there was another part of her which she herself could not understand. It was not sentimental liking of the prisoner. She had come to think of him as a prisoner. She had not liked him even yesterday when he had said in his impulsive way, "Anyway, let me tell you that my name is Tom." She had only bowed her little distant bow. She saw hurt in his eyes, but she did not wish to assuage it. Indeed, he was a great trouble in this house. So as Hannah stood on the veranda arranging the flowers, the servants discussed the matter in her presence, as they wanted her to know their views about the matter. Hannah also felt that the servants were right, but she had some feelings for the injured man, which she could also not analyze. She did not like the prisoner, neither was she attached to him. The day before, the injured man told her that his name was Tom. Hannah did not like him at that moment also. She had reacted by bowing her head mildly. She saw that her reaction hurt the injured man, but she did not want to reduce this hurt that she had caused to him, because the injured man was a great trouble to her. His presence was a threat to Hannah and Sadao. This instance is the third time that Hannah affirms she does not like the prisoner, an internal argument that is beginning to sound defensive. This is also one of the two times in which Buck uses the word sentimental to mean to convey something that is overly emotional, which is the very word Buck's critics use to classify and criticize her work. I'm ending the lesson over here today. Thank you, students. Om Namah Shivaya.